Okay, guys, so I want to start kind of the same way that we usually do. Just kind of reminding you what our sketchbook assignment is, when it's due, all that kind of stuff. April 25th, your keys, a drawing of your keys is due. Use pencil. Some of the last few sketchbook assignments, I haven't been really specific with what my expectations were as far as media goes. But for your keys, I want you to use graphite. You can use mechanical pencil, regular pencil, I don't really care. But notice the S on the end of keys, multiple keys. If you have a lanyard, if you have keychains, then add that in. I would also kind of tell you to think about your guidelines to successful composition. Think about zooming in, you know, having things run off the edge of the page, all those things to get you the most points possible on that sketch. Being that it is an observational sketch, I'm going to grade it a little bit more harshly, I guess, or a little bit more difficult, just because at this point you should have really worked with the pencil enough that you should be able to show me a high quality drawing of your keys. There's some straight lines there. It should be, you know, for those of you that aren't really organic or creative, this is an opportunity for you just to draw what you see and do well with that. Other than that, today we're going to talk about visual culture, which I talked about at the very end of yesterday. And then tomorrow we'll get back into your grid drawings. Today is kind of a nice little break for that. And those are due at the end of class tomorrow. So if, however, you aren't going to be done in that time, I will allow you to turn it in to me on Friday. But I want to grade those over the weekend, and so you can get a grade like at the halfway point, have your drawings for that grid project graded, so that if you struggle with the painting process, at least you got a good grade on the drawing before you covered that drawing with paint. So that's kind of the goal. Are there any questions for me as of right now? Okay. Friday drawing, for those of you that were not here this past Friday for different reasons, we'll go over the guidelines to that again. I know some of you were here and heard that last week, but I did have 8 or 10 of you that were not here. So we'll go over those guidelines again. I'll kind of talk about my experience with making artwork with meaning, and then we'll kind of get into the process and try to get the planning moving along. Those will be due the last Friday that you are here. So if you're a senior and you're gone a few days early, your due date will be different than the underclassmen that will be here another, you know, three or four days after you're gone. So that's kind of the deal. And I'll get that specific deadline to you, but you'll have every Friday until the end of the school year. So I want to go ahead and get started on the visual culture stuff. I'm going to get a paper passed out to you here. But last night, I asked you to look up the term visual culture. What is a definition of visual culture? Or what did we talk about briefly yesterday? Hayden? Okay. So the aspects of culture expressed through visual means. Brooke, you got an extra? Okay, were there any other maybe more layman's terms or how you see visual culture? What does it mean to you? Anybody, what did we talk about at the end of class yesterday? What is visual culture? How did I describe it? Brooke?
Media and how it affects you.
Okay, media and how it affects you. That's fair. What else? Hayden?
Stuff you see and what it makes you think.
Right. That's really as general as it can get. Stuff you see and the way it makes you think. So in that first area, the question is, what is visual culture? How do you define the term? I want this to be your words. Don't give me a Webster's dictionary term. Give me what your wording would be. How you interpret visual culture. And if you really don't understand yet, because we haven't talked about it much, then just use the two words, visual and culture. What do those two words mean individually? Give me something here. So yesterday in this, at the end of class, I asked you to raise your hand if you thought visual images changed the way you live your life, or they kind of influence the way you do things or the way you see the world. I had 26 out of 31 raise their hand yesterday. So there were five of you that felt like imagery in our society has no impact on your life. Hopefully after today, you can kind of start to see that it should be, in all likelihood, 31 out of 31 should feel that imagery affects how you change your life, or how you see your life, I'm sorry. So we're going to look at some pictures today. We're going to view a couple commercials and just kind of look at imagery that you see on a daily basis that you kind of take for granted. We see so many images all day, every day, that you start to become numb to it. You don't see how much it affects you. So hopefully today we can kind of see a little bit more into it and slow down and actually think about it and talk about it, rather than just let the images kind of rein in and be numb to it. So then the second question is, what is Mr. Archer's definition of visual culture? And that definition is the study of images and how they affect the person viewing them. So it's the study of images and how they affect the person viewing them. That's always a weak point for me, but I'm guessing it's an E. When in doubt, go with an E.
That's what I said.
I don't know. That's why I teach art. I don't know. Ask an English teacher and get back to me. Let me grab you a paper. Okay, so we've talked about, To a light degree, we've talked about what visual culture is. It's imagery. It's things you see on a daily basis. So what are those specific examples? That's kind of what that next area is. What specific examples of imagery can you think of? What do we see? Somebody I haven't heard from yet. Ramona? Commercials. Excellent. That's kind of number one. That's what you see every time you turn on the TV for a couple minutes between shows, or, you know, I don't even know, probably you see 10 or 15 commercials every show that you watch, every 30-minute show. What else is there out there? Tyler?
I'm trying to play a game on the iPhone and it just takes over your screen.
Okay, so ads when you're playing games on your phone. So there's smartphone devices or ads on smartphones. Yeah, Justin? Movie posters, that's a good one. That's one I feel like, as there's been more and more images added as time goes on here, movie posters are a little bit less visible. Used to be billboards and things showing movie posters, and now I feel like there's so many other images going on that they kind of get drowned out. But yeah, that's definitely an instance. Anthony? Okay, so there's advertisements. Now that's a little bit different. You have to start to make a decision. Is it visual culture to have a sound come on? If you're listening to something, is a radio commercial visual culture? And that's kind of an interpretation thing. I don't know if audio culture fits in with this visual culture. That's something I hadn't thought of, but that makes sense. Zach?
Would audio give you visual culture if it gives you like a sense of imagery?
Yeah, I would say. If you, I don't know, what do you think? Is audio culture or something you hear, would you consider that to be in the same category as visual culture? Nick, what do you think?
It gives you the picture.
Okay, so if it creates like a mental image?
Yeah.
Okay, that makes sense. Megan, what do you think?
I agree with Nick. If it creates a picture in your head, then it counts.
Okay, that's interesting. That's something I'd studied this a lot at Ohio State. Visual culture was something that our head professor, that was like his thing that he created, kind of, is the idea of visual culture. And I don't think we ever really talked about what audio does in visual culture, because they're usually two separate, very separate things. What's another venue, or what's something else you see visual culture in? Go ahead, Mackenzie. Okay, so packaging, excellent. So if you see, go to Kroger and you pick anything off the shelf, it has been designed to appeal to you, whether it's the colors or the design, or you know, there's different aspects that go into being appealing, but everything that you see or buy has been designed to appeal to your eye. Zach?
With genres of music, yeah.
Because
I mean, when you listen to a country song, it's like you get like a certain different feel than when you listen to like a pop song.
Okay, okay, and that could be tied to when you hear that music, you think of like the music video, or you think of like the imagery that is related to that. I could see that. Yeah, Michael? Okay, so yeah, the clothes you wear, that's a good one. I'm kind of a brand snob. I like my Nike, I like Under Armour, I like all those things. And really, when you look at it, the quality of the clothes might not be any different, but I'm a brand guy. I like to have that image of Nike, of Under Armour, of you know Ralph Lauren, whatever it is. I'm just, you know, that's kind of what our culture has become, is it's important to have logos and identification of a certain visual culture. Tyler?
Oh, I'm saying could certain types of pop art be visual culture?
Yeah. Yes, so art itself, anything that you can see that it is an image, that is considered visual culture, especially more so ones that are visible to the mass of our society. So things like street art, pop art, things that are very visible, those are things that are going to be considered more visual culture. So these are awesome examples. One that I think is kind of changing as time goes is magazines. I think with the emergence of technology and the continual growth of technology, there are less and less magazines present. But that's one thing I think of is ads in magazines. I think now there are more ads online. Companies are probably spending more time on online, or more money on online advertisement than they were, 10 years ago or 5 years ago. It's now kind of taken over completely. So from here, what I want to do is show a couple commercials, two that are very, very different, and kind of talk about each one individually and then kind of compare the two and see, you know, just start to look at some images and see what kind of comes from that discussion. So go ahead and get things fired up here. So the first commercial is more lighthearted. It's one of my favorites that I've seen, a Super Bowl commercial from a couple years ago. It's a funny commercial. And then the second one's a little bit more serious. So again, we'll stop after this one. It's pretty short. The other commercial's a little bit longer. But we'll see, you know, what was going on, what was the goal here.
Hi.
Jalen, Kyle.
Jalen, you play nice.
I'll be right back.
What's going on, man? I see you got your game skills down pat. You might have your hands full once I pick up the controller.
Put it back. Keep your hands on my mama. Keep your hands on my Doritos.
Jalen, are you playing nice?
Okay, so what was going on here? Like, what was the story? So, what was it, Nick?
That guy was going on a date with that kid's mom.
Okay, so the older guy was going on a date with the kid's mom. Then what happened? What, Anthony?
Tried to jack the Doritos.
So, what is going on here? What is Doritos trying to do? Because they don't make an image to be funny just because. What is their goal? Cheyenne?
Make
Right. So they're implying that the Doritos are so good that the little boy is angered by someone taking his Doritos. Anthony, you have your hand up, or you're just hanging out with your hand up? Okay. What's another kind of goal that Doritos could have here? So we have one that the Doritos are so good that it makes the little boy angry. Megan?
They want you to buy Doritos.
They want you to buy Doritos. Why spend the money and spend the time to put together an ad, especially an ad for the Super Bowl? How much money does a Super Bowl ad cost? I don't even know the numbers on that. I mean, millions upon millions of dollars for a 39-second ad. But they want you to buy Doritos. So what kind of tool are they using to get you to buy Doritos? Humor. Excellent. So usually in Super Bowl commercials, there's either humor or there's like some serious sadness or something. Like the Budweiser commercials sometimes get very emotional. Other commercials get emotional. They try to pull you in. Any image you see that doesn't create an emotion is not doing its job. So if you see this and as a commercial that is not funny and it doesn't kind of make you emotional in any way, is it successful? Yes, no, okay, no. You want to be, the goal of this advertising agency is to get you involved, to make you stop what you're doing. A lot of times I'm guilty of it. I'm sure you guys are somewhat guilty of it. Checking your phone when whatever your show or your game or whatever goes to commercial, they want to get your attention back to their product. So, you know, by humor or by whatever means necessary, they want to get your attention. Does that make sense? So this is, it's interesting, even though this is a funny commercial and it's not as serious, there's still some interpretation to be had here of why this was the chosen story. So I'm going to go ahead and show the other commercial. This one could possibly spike a little bit more discussion because it is a little bit more serious tone.
I showed up to a place I'd never been, and there was a guy with a drafting board.
We couldn't see them. They couldn't see us.
Tell me about your hair.
I didn't know what he was doing, but then I could tell after several questions that he was drawing me.
Tell me about your chin.
It kind of protrudes a little bit, especially when I smile.
Your jaw?
My mom told me I had a big jaw.
What would be your most prominent feature?
Kind of a fat, rounder face.
The older I've gotten, the more freckles I've gotten.
I'd say I have a pretty big forehead.
Once I get a sketch, I say thank you very much, and then they leave. I don't see them.
All I had been told before the sketch was to get friendly with this other woman, Chloe.
Today I'm going to ask you some questions about a person you met earlier, and I'm going to ask you some general questions about their face.
She was thin, so you could see her cheekbones. And her chin, it was a nice, thin chin.
She had nice eyes. They lit up when she spoke.
Cute nose.
She had blue eyes, very nice blue eyes.
So here we are. This is the sketch that you helped me create. And that's a sketch that somebody described of you.
So yeah, that's... closed off and fatter, sadder too. The second one looks more open, friendly, and happy. I should be more grateful of my natural beauty. It impacts the choices and the friends that we make, the jobs we apply for, how we treat our children. It impacts everything. It couldn't be more critical to your happiness.
Do you think you're more beautiful than you say?
Yeah.
We spend a lot of time as women analyzing and trying to fix the things that aren't quite right. And we should spend more time appreciating the things that we do like.
Okay, so what happened here? What was this commercial about?
Real beauty and self-perception.
Okay, so beauty and self, what do you say, perception?
Yeah.
Okay. I buy that. What else? What was more kind of tangible? What was going on? What actually happened in this commercial? Somebody I haven't heard from yet. Hannah, what actually happened in this commercial?
Woman described how she looked at herself to a person so they could draw her, and then she met somebody else, and they described her to the sketch.
Okay, so the woman describes herself to a sketch artist, and then someone else that had just met her described her to a sketch artist. And those images, how did they differ? Grace, what was the difference between the way people perceive themselves and the way that others perceive them?
Some women are harsher on themselves than other people see them.
Okay. I hear that. Now, Grace, you don't have to answer this, but she said some women perceive themselves differently than other people do. Does that only apply to women? No? Jaden, you're shaking your head no. Do you feel like it's an equal representation between male and female? Or okay. Okay, so there's self-esteem issues, or there's this imagery that you create in your head of what you look like in comparison to what other people see. And I think that does cross both male and female. There's not really... Maybe it's more commonly seen in the media that females have that issue, but I think it's just as prevalent in males, especially, you know, later on in life. I feel like that happens. But anyways, what I want to do now, and hopefully you got something out of that, is start to think about that advertisement. Okay, how did that company appeal to you? What were they trying to do? First and foremost, we talked about this with the Doritos ad. What are they trying to do?
Make you buy Dove.
Make you buy Dove. Did they do a good job?
Not really.
Not really. Why not, Kaylee?
It's not really something I look into.
Okay.
I don't really see what's the point of it.
Okay.
Like, so there's other stuff that can make you feel like that.
Okay. I see that. That makes sense. Jackson?
I feel like throughout the commercial, you forgot what you were actually watching.
Right. Right, and that's interesting. So Jackson says he felt like he forgot what he was watching. He forgot that it was an advertisement. So I want to touch on what Kaylee said. She said that it doesn't apply to her. Is there anybody else that felt like this really didn't apply to you? You just didn't, you weren't interested. It didn't make sense to you? No? Well, any advertisement appeals to a certain group of people. There's going to be people that get it and people that don't get it as far as it doesn't apply to you or it does apply to you. That's just something when you're an advertiser, you have to choose your market. And I feel like you guys being younger, this does apply a little bit more. Whereas if you were 90 years old, maybe this commercial wouldn't apply. Those things kind of are things that happen. It may apply or it may not. And what Jackson said I thought was very interesting. And he said that he forgot what he was watching. How many times did you see Dove, the brand of soap for the commercial? How many times did you see it throughout the commercial?
Once.
I counted at the end. It was 3 seconds. What does that make of it, or what can you make of that? Is that a good thing? Is it a bad thing? Tyler Brower. Right. Right. Yeah. When I saw this, that's kind of the way I thought. Justin.
To me, it felt like you accidentally flipped the channel to some weird documentary.
Okay. Okay. So that makes sense. So you felt like you were on something else, a different show, a different channel. How many people felt like this was an effective commercial? Raise your hands. I want to see. Okay. So... raise them so I can count them. Kennedy's like, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's interesting to me. I feel like this was an awesome commercial. Today in culture, you're like bombarded with images. Like, buy our product, buy our product, buy our product. To me, it was interesting and refreshing to see something that was a little bit different. It did tie in my emotions, and I thought, you know what, that's a really cool commercial. Anthony. Okay.
They didn't, like, really say what it was doing or, like, the effects were really kind of like.
Okay. So it didn't really feel like an advertisement? Hayden?
Yeah. It's like the primary purpose wasn't to advertise Dove. They were trying to get the self-beauty thing out there.
Right.
But unless you're saying, hey, Dove can help you with that, it's not really specifically
right.
promoting their product.
So it's kind of a subliminal advertisement type thing?
Good and then saying Dove instead of saying this.
Right.
Is good.
Right. Tyler?
It took way too long to get to the point.
Okay. So attention span.
Yeah.
Something that, you know, you need it now. You know, as technology happens and
yeah,
Snapchat's, you live in 10-second increments of your life or whatever, you know, that's attention span. That's something people need to pay attention to. It makes sense. Cheyenne, did you have something?
Yeah, I was going to say, like, they were more focused on what people thought of them, like, I guess, like, people working there more than, like, their actual, like,
right.
Like, when you see that, like, maybe I don't use Dove. I don't know if they sell soap or
right.
all this. I just
okay.
Use Dove.
Okay. So, yeah, there wasn't much brand recognition. There wasn't a Dove soap or this is what it can do for you. It wasn't very visual. So that's interesting to me. I found it very powerful, and I thought it worked very well. But that could be that I'm, you know, of a different kind of demographic than you guys are. But that just kind of goes to show you that different people are affected in different ways. So what I want to do now is kind of move into some actual still images. And I think this can really spark some good conversation. I'm happy with what we're getting so far. Let's see. So we talked about the definition, study of images in a given society and how those images impact the lives of the viewer. That's just a little bit more wordy than what I had you write down. Here's just some images I pulled. I typed in visual culture and this is what popped up. The most famous visual culture image that basically has the most controversy is McDonald's, for multiple reasons. You know, whether it is kind of starting the idea of fast food and the idea of Super Size Me. How many people have seen that documentary, Super Size Me? It's kind of crazy, isn't it? It's bizarre. But from that documentary, I think the imagery of McDonald's and what it means and how it's making America fat is kind of taken McDonald's logo and turned it into a pop culture icon. But other images in here are just, you know, Barbie doll. There's a lot of conversation about the Barbie doll and how it's the ideal female figure, all of that kind of thing, to kind of really spark a discussion more so than it being a girl's toy, but being kind of a cultural icon. I thought the Pepsi sign was kind of funny. I'd never seen that before this morning. I thought that was interesting. It looks like a fat guy bending over. But yeah, these are just random images that mean something. Each one of these should be somewhat, you know, relatable for you. MTV used to be music television. Now I don't know if I've seen a music video on MTV in like 5 years. It feels like it's always Ridiculousness or like Real World. But, so here's the first image I want to talk about, and I don't want to give you much. I'll talk about this image for a second in the fact that I, in college, took a class that was based on visual culture, and analyzing images. We talked about this picture specifically for 3 2-hour classes. I spent 6 hours talking about this image. There were 24 of us in our class, and at one point the professor just stopped talking and said, figure it out. What is going on? Why is this powerful? Why is it right? Why is it wrong? And we had to like write a paper about it. The professor literally for that middle class, for that second class, he just sat there and just stared at us until we started having a discussion and figuring out what he was trying to get out of it. So let's break it down. What is going on? What's just visually, what does it look like? Be as obvious as you want to be. Hayden?
There are several shiny men.
Okay, there are four shiny men and one shiny woman. Mackenzie?
They all have like the perfect ideal body type.
Okay, so they all have the perfect body type, quote unquote. Megan? Okay, excellent. That's kind of the most, in my opinion, the most important part of the image is the male in the middle is using force to hold down the female. Kenzie?
The men in the picture are just like watching him.
Okay, so the rest of the males are just standing there. Where is the gaze, or where is... Where are each individual looking?
Okay.
Okay. So that's interesting. Nick pointed out, and some of you that are farther away, this may be harder to see, but the guy farthest back, he's not looking here. What does that kind of imply? Any thought?
There's something off into the distance, probably.
Okay, there could be something going on back here behind the viewer, or behind the cameraman, or the you know your point of view. Something going on behind you. Yeah, Tyler.
Some one guy got sunglasses on.
Yes, he has sunglasses on. He has sunglasses on. What could that mean?
Sunglasses are cool.
Okay, sunglasses are cool. It's bright out. What do? Okay. The amount of oil on other skin is causing reflection. There's really so many symbols here to break down that you can start to see with just the short discussion we've had so far that there is a lot going on here, more so than you see to start with. What kind of idea, the sunglasses, as silly as it seems, what could that be, like metaphorically, or what could it be? A symbol of he's shady, I guess. If you want to go that route, he's shady. Zach.
He doesn't want to look at with his own eyes what he's doing.
Exactly. That's exactly what I would say. Zach said he doesn't want to have her look in his eyes. He's not proud of what he's doing. And there's a lot of different things that could be implied of what's going on, but one way that people. Or one reason people would wear sunglasses is to shield their eyes, shield their identity, or kind of feel like a protection of themselves. How many have watched Big Daddy before? The movie Adam Sandler? Michael, what's the connection I'm trying to make to Big Daddy?
When his kid puts on the sunglasses, so he's like invisible.
So the little kid, Sonny, right? Isn't that the kid's name, Sonny?
Yeah.
Sonny puts on sunglasses so that he's invisible. Adam Sandler makes him believe that you put on these sunglasses, nobody can see you anymore. So as crazy as it is, in that college class, we had like a 20-minute discussion about why Sonny was this kid or this guy. Like he has his sunglasses on to kind of shield his identity. And maybe the person that works for Dolce & Gabbana or the ad agency didn't have all of these underlying concepts. But as the viewer, you have the power to create the storyline, and see all of these images, or see all of these things that you are seeing. You know, they might have taken the picture and not told this guy to stare off into the distance. Maybe he was supposed to be looking here and he just wasn't, and it turned out to be a beautiful picture. You know, you have the power as the viewer to kind of make your own interpretation. Justin.
What is this ad
So, exactly. What is it advertising? What is the potential advertisement here?
Oil.
Dolce & Gabbana oil. That's a, it's a real possibility. So we have all, I've heard it's fashion, like it's jewelry, or not jewelry, it's handbags. Nick says it could be cologne. Yeah, it's true. There's no bag. So if they make handbags, maybe how is this doing anything? So my guess would be clothing. I'm guessing maybe cologne. Sometimes cologne and perfume ads get a little out there. But exactly. The question is, what are they selling? Are they doing a good job selling what they want to sell? Selling sex appeal, they're not selling a product. So I feel like this is somewhat of a failure, in my opinion. But when you think about audience and you think about who this is slanted towards, is this your demographic? How many people feel like this is something you would see in a magazine that you would read? Okay, Brooke shamefully raises her hand. Yeah, I feel like this is a little bit different than anything I've seen in my magazines. Then again, and like, yeah, in Bassmaster and Woodworker magazine, I don't see too many Dolce & Gabbana ads. So we'll move on to the next image. I know there was really good discussion there. How many people are familiar with this image?
No.
Okay, awesome. Awesome. So who's here? Who is this? LeBron? Okay, LeBron James is one. Does anybody know who the girl in the dress is? It is not Aaron Andrews. Nick says Gisele Bündchen. Mrs. Tom Brady. So is there anything that can be interpreted from this image? Mackenzie? They're happy? Okay, she looks happy.
I think that's a scream what? Of excitement.
Okay, scream of excitement. Zach?
Power.
Okay, who has the power here?
They both do. They're both very powerful people.
Okay. They're both powerful people. I would agree with that. In the image, does one look more threatening than the other?
Yeah.
Who looks threatening, Kaylee?
I'd rather have the dude.
LeBron. LeBron James. So why does LeBron look threatening? Because he's screaming. His emotion on his face is fierce. He's a big dude. He's
taking a wide stance.
Yes, he's got a wide
bigger and intimidate enemies.
Right. He's got a wide aggressive stance. She's kind of just like happy. She seems pretty carefree. Now I'm gonna show you one more image. This image should change 100% what you're seeing right here.
Oh my gosh, it's World War
II. Okay, so how does this change what you are seeing?
Well, it gets super racist.
Hayden, why? Exactly. It is depicting LeBron as an animalistic version of what? Who is this?
German.
It is King Kong.
Oh, it's as yeah,
as a German. Yeah. Nick, how did you know that?
Because we learned about it last week.
Oh, you learned about this, both of these images, or just the right one? Okay, so what era is this from, the right image?
World War One.
So Nick, since you know about it, what's the storyline behind the image on the right?
They're trying to get people in the West to destroy the basically barbaric Germans.
Okay, so the goal was to get people to enlist in the army or in the services to destroy the barbaric Germans. And these are Europeans, correct? Or who was? And to be honest, I just have studied the image. I don't know much about the history of the right image. I just know the kind of tie between the two. But how does seeing this change your opinion of this? Does this make you, now if we step back, does this make you a little bit uncomfortable now that you know what the history is?
Yes.
Is there anybody in here that did not have a change? Like you're still like, oh, it's just LeBron and Giselle. Okay, Brooke, Michael, that's fine. Nothing wrong with that, Cheyenne. But to me, it immediately, I had Hayden's opinion. Racism, like right off. Why would LeBron subject himself to this? He had a choice. You know, he could have said no and put somebody else on the cover. Like, I'm not doing that. Maybe he didn't know. But he has publicists, he has all these people that know. So, you know, why allow it to happen? Okay, money. Money makes people do crazy things. True. So, without getting too much more in depth, I wanted you to kind of, you know, see the context of images and what is, you know, possible there. So now what I want to do is I'm going to give your group, your table, an image. And then on your worksheet, your goal is to kind of answer those questions about your specific image. And then we'll kind of review them as a class. What I want you to do is have your discussion, describe the image, then kind of analyze it and answer those questions as you go. You've got 5 minutes starting now. That would be in like the NICU, like after a newborn is taken, you know, for tests and all that kind of stuff, it would be taken to the NICU.
That's the big thing with hospital and no matter how
why that's
are we doing the back?
Yes, the back as well. Back of the paper.
Is that what you're trying to tell me?
Yes. Guys, there is a back of the paper as well.
An Islamic woman who they're like, because you know ISIS and stuff, like they just want them in jail because like, they're coming.
There's different interpretations. That's fine. If that's what you see, that's what you see.
She's the only one.
Then
Mackenzie are coming with this.
It's fine. If you had a room of 100 people, there would be 15 different interpretations of what's going on here. You can have your discussion. That's fine. Just write down your personal opinion. And then on the back, there's a space for you to write down what the possible like counter opinions are, what the other opinions are. What I want to do, we only have a couple minutes left, but I want to start to have a couple of these discussions. I'm hearing excellent things as I come around. Let's start with the one that's up on the board. Which groups? I had two groups with this image. What is your interpretation of what is going on? Tyler Brower.
At first sight, it seems like a victory pose, but then you realize that with his arms and face, it creates a cross, which kind of makes it look like crucifixion.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's really creepy because he's like, red makes him look all bloody, and he looks like he's...
Okay.
And then when you look at the color scheme and the cross, you know that it's the St. George Cross of England.
Okay.
It still kind of relays it to crucifixion, but
right.
In a way.
Right. So seeing this pose kind of builds like an inherent cross or a crucifixion type scene. How did your opinion differ from that? Was there anything different that you guys had?
We said that too, but we also said that it's like we thought it was kind of like supposed to be like a flag, like with the
okay.
white background.
Okay.
Country.
Okay. And those that aren't familiar, which I'm not, I don't watch soccer or football. This is Wayne Rooney, who is a professional soccer player, very, very excellent soccer player. So that may change. It's not just a fan in the stands. It's a you know one of the all stars of the sport. Justin.
I didn't have the app, but it actually made me feel like it was a soccer player.
Okay. Okay. I see that. He does look like a soccer player. How does this change the image? If I were to take the Nike sign out of the corner, how does this then change what's going on? Yeah. Yeah, it takes a turn. Like, it changes just from blocking this out. And in all honesty, this is so powerful. I don't know that I really see this until I really look at the image. But it definitely takes a turn and changes a little bit. Anthony?
What soccer team does your
coach wear? That I couldn't tell you.
Looks like a Swedish flag.
So let's see. This one. Caitlin, you had some interpretation of this that was interesting. What did you have to say?
When I first saw it, I didn't see the small text at the bottom, so I kind of laughed because of the dress.
All right, guys, so hand your papers to me as you leave. Good discussion today. Excellent work. I really like what we got out of this.